Welcome to the Popcorn Talk Network, for the online broadcast network that features movie discussion, news, and interviews. Press one.
Popcorn Talk. We talk movies.
From the Popcorn Talk Network, the online broadcast network for movie talk, Alicia Malone with Scott Movie Mantz and the Schmoes Know. This is Profiles, in-depth spotlights on the greatest filmmakers and artists in motion picture history.
Hello, Profilers, and live from Hollywood, Encino.
Same thing.
Episode 18 of Profiles, our last Profiles of 2014.
That's why we're wearing Christmas sweaters.
We are wearing our Christmas sweaters. Season's greetings to profilers from around the world. We are going out the year with a very, very special show.
Big Bang.
Big Bang, Paul Thomas Anderson. And what is it about this extraordinary filmmaker that makes him your jam?
He is my jam.
Yeah.
I love Paul Thomas Anderson because, I mean, he's been called the West Coast Scorsese.
Yep.
And you can see that in terms of the camera movements that he chooses and sometimes the subject matter. He's also been compared to Robert Altman because of the great ensemble cast in some of his movies. But he has a style that is definitely all his own. And this kind of sounds a little pretentious, but he is an auteur.
He is an auteur who, with his seventh film, Inherent Vice, he has now directed seven movies. He wrote the screenplays for all the movies he directed. Scorsese is a major influence, obviously Robert Altman.
Yep.
And there are other filmmakers as well. He works with a lot of the same actors. John C. Reilly, Philip Baker Hall, Julianne Moore, Louise Guzman, William H. Macy. And one thing that we both discovered doing our research for this very special episode is that our tribute to Paul Thomas Anderson is also serving as a tribute to the late, great Philip Seymour Hoffman.
And it's incredible when you rewatch all PTA's movies that Philip Seymour Hoffman appeared in, how different he is in each film.
I mean, you
compare his role in Magnolia to his role in The Master, and they're completely different.
Completely different.
Another thing I love about Paul Thomas Anderson is his cinematography.
It is like
porn for people who love cinematography. Every shot is carefully constructed, and his movies are really well thought out, very considered, challenging to the audience. They're not fun movies, escapist movies, but I like that. That is my jam. And we had such a hard time trying to put our five favorites in some kind of order. So I am monitoring YouTube right now to see people's comments, and I'm sure we'll get a lot of like, what? You put that at number five? You put that
but
at number
three? But that's good.
We like debate.
We like debate.
And I'll try and read out some of these right now. It's about Christmas sweaters.
Yes.
And Greeno86 says, Mantz doesn't seem to be on Red Bull, saying that maybe it just hasn't kicked in yet. He has.
I have had a Red Bull.
Watch out.
Look out. You know we're in trouble.
My hand's going to be sore because it's
Duck
been so much
for
up.
Cover. Wow. Yes. What? One more.
But, really
but the other thing about Paul Thomas Anderson is that, you know, with these seven films, while the influence of these other directors are there, other filmmakers, making him an auteur, they are uniquely his own.
And they're also different from each other.
No two movies are alike.
But you can tell that it's his movies.
The other thing is doing research for Profiles, and you know, we love doing research for Profiles because we get to rewatch these movies again.
It's a tough job.
Like, that's work? What?
It's a really hard
that's
job.
That's what we do, Alicia
Malone? I know. Malone? It's the best.
But tell me I'm wrong here, or tell me if I'm wrong, when I say that rewatching these movies, I keep liking them more and more each time I see them.
I agree.
That was especially the case with There Will Be Blood, and that was especially the case of revisionist look back on The Master. Completely changed my opinion
of
that film.
I can't wait to hear what you have to say about that one.
Yep.
But right now, let's go to a segment that is very fitting for this time of year.
Very fitting.
It's A Wonderful Life.
And an angel is going to get their wings.
Roll it.
Paul Thomas Anderson was born on June 26, 1970 in Studio City, California. He is the third youngest of nine children, and his father, Ernie, made his name as the voice of ABC TV and as a late-night horror movie host known as Goulardi. Where most young aspiring filmmakers cut their teeth making movies with their Super 8 cameras, Anderson started making movies with a Betamax camera that his father bought for him when he was 12 years old. Using the money he earned cleaning cages at a pet store while he was a senior at Montclair Prep High School, Anderson filmed his first real production, a 30-minute mockumentary called The Dirk Diggler Story, which of course served as the inspiration for his breakthrough feature, 1997's Boogie Nights. That was followed by the film short Cigarettes and Coffee, which cost $20,000 to make and was screened at the 1993 Sundance Film Festival. Anderson made his feature directorial debut with the 1996 ensemble Hard Eight, which was screened at that year's Cannes Film Festival. And with the six films that followed, including his latest, Inherent Vice, Anderson established himself as one of the most distinctive and revered filmmaking voices of his generation. Paul Thomas Anderson has been nominated for 5 Academy Awards, 3 for writing, 1 for directing, and 1 for Best Picture.
Yeah. Wow. And you know, he is married to Maya Rudolph.
I know.
And they have 3 kids.
That's so cool.
That is very, very cool.
And she appears in Inherent Vice, which is his new movie. I want to give a quick shout out to Rachel Cushing, who says she's homesick from work today, so she gets to watch us. So thank you so much. We always appreciate your comments, Rachel.
And feel better, Rachel, and keep writing your reviews. You are an amazing film critic. Lover of film just like we are. Lover of these kinds of movies. Let's talk about your First Blood for PTA.
First Blood, I think we probably have the same First Blood, and that is Boogie Nights.
Of course.
I didn't see it in cinema because I was too young at the time, but I watched it on VHS. Luckily, I knew the local video shop guy because I was in there every single week. So he was like, okay, I know you're not old enough for this movie, but here you go. And I loved it. I first actually heard about it through the soundtrack. All my friends had the soundtrack. And listening to the soundtrack, I thought it would be a lot lighter than it is, but it is a lot of fun to watch. It's just at the end, it takes a turn. Mark Wahlberg, though, this was the movie that made me say, oh, he can act. He's not just
Marky Mark and the Funky Bunch.
He's Calvin. No, he actually has acting chops. He was perfect in this role.
He was perfect in this role, and this is a perfect movie.
Is your First Blood, too?
It is my First Blood, too. Yeah. I mean, of course it was. It came out in 1997, October 10th, and I just remember, of course, it is a very hot, a very sexy and stylish movie, but it is a loving tribute, not just to Martin Scorsese, but to Martin Scorsese's Goodfellas. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you take those two films, they run about the same length, about 2.5 hours. They mirror each other in style and structure so much.
The rise, the fall, the redemption.
The rise, the fall, the redemption. And the midpoint, which actually happens more than 2/3 of the way through the movie, changes everything.
Yep.
But it was the style of that movie. And also, hey, look, the tracking shots, like the beginning of the film.
That beginning shot.
I mean, that's like that the tracking shot from Goodfellas.
It is. It's like a Coppola shot.
But this is an incredible film. We're going to talk a lot about this one.
But right now, let's go Fast Five. Number 5, which is
I drink your milkshake. I drink it up.
There Will Be Blood. And I saw a comment before saying if There Will Be Blood is not number 1 on your list, There Will Be Blood.
Oh, so, boy.
Apologies. A lot of people saying that this was actually their First Blood. The Doctor 2012 says my First Blood is There Will Be Blood. And Cole Boone said my First Blood is There Will Be Blood. What a great one to start off with.
That's a good one to start off with. Well, hey, it is number 5 on our list. But in our 5-1, there's not a wide margin between each one.
No.
Anyone of these movies could have been number 1 for us.
Exactly.
But this one came out on December 26, 2007, nominated for 8 Academy Awards.
Christmas movie, then?
Yeah, nothing says Christmas more than a milkshake.
Cool.
But it's nominated for 8 Oscars, 3 of them for PTA, for screenplay, for director, and for best picture, because he also produced it. It won 2 Academy Awards, cinematography for Robert Elswit, so deserved.
So beautiful.
And DDL, Daniel Day-Lewis as Daniel Plainview.
Amazing.
Amazing film. Cost $25 million to make. It made $76 million worldwide.
Well, I noticed when I was rewatching this film a couple of things. Mm-hmm. Firstly, how brutal it is.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, it really hit me again. The third, fourth, I think I've seen this 4 or 5 times now. Every time I'm just floored by the brutality in it, how dark it is, how apocalyptic it is. And then also how there is no dialogue for really the first 15 minutes. There is, he says no, and then he says there she is at about the 4-minute, 5-minute mark, but there's no chunk of dialogue until later on. PTA said he wanted to make a whole film without dialogue, which I think he could do. And he said, I got the closest to that with the opening of There Will Be Blood.
But between the fact that there's hardly any dialogue, between the fact that there are a lot of scenes where just there is no dialogue and this, there are long tracking shots, and of course, the score by Johnny Greenwood.
That's what really struck me as well, how haunting it is. It's really, it has a sense of dread about it.
That is why, even though PTA's influences are clearly Scorsese and Altman, I felt like There Will Be Blood was PTA channeling Stanley Kubrick.
Okay. Explain.
Okay, well, just because of the long tracking shots, because there's no dialogue. Remember in 2001, A Space Odyssey, there was no dialogue for the first 21 minutes of that movie.
Yeah, that's true.
And the score was very reminiscent of 2001,
like
A Space Odyssey.
Hmm.
Yeah. But listen, this is a great American film. I mean, this is very comparable. You and I discussed this earlier.
Citizen Kane. All about capitalism.
All about greed and corruption.
Yeah.
But there's also a faith element to this film.
Yeah, the tagline is "When ambition meets faith," which is a perfect tagline for it. The themes are definitely religion as well as capitalism. There's so much to meditate on with this movie. It's so challenging to watch. It's not that fun, but it's really well made. I love Paul Dano. It gets under your skin and it really stays there. And I've also heard comparisons between Daniel Day-Lewis's character Daniel Plainview and Dracula.
Oh, no
and
way.
And he does literally
suck your blood.
The blood of the earth.
Yeah, well, that's an excellent point. The other thing about Daniel Day-Lewis's character, his dialect, the way he did his vocal inflection, he was clearly inspired and knowingly took from writer, director, actor John Huston.
Yeah.
John Huston's 1948 classic, The Treasure of the Sierra Madre, was a movie that Paul Thomas Anderson watched almost every night for a while before he started filming There Will Be Blood. So John Huston had a big impact on these filmmakers.
Well, my question for you is, when you first watched the movie, did you get confused whether Paul Dano was playing twins or the same? I got quite confused at first.
I still don't know for sure that they are twins.
Well, the interesting thing behind that is I was doing more research on it, and apparently, so Daniel Day-Lewis had a year to prepare for this role, which is what he insists for every single role. Paul Dano, 4 days.
Whoa.
Because he was cast as Paul, but Eli was going to be played by someone else. That person dropped out, so they said, okay, can you do both characters? So he had 4 days to prepare that role, and he's so good. Those sermons. Get out!
He held his own. Boy, did Paul Dano really hold his own against Daniel Day-Lewis. That ain't easy. No way.
Really, really hard to do. The Doctor 2012 says, in my opinion, I think There Will Be Blood is Daniel Day-Lewis's best performance as Daniel Plainview. And a lot of people saying, yes, I totally agree. And Liam Legrand, who's watching from Australia, where I think it's about 7 a.m. in the morning.
Hey there, Liam.
He says he loves John Huston, so that's nice.
Oh, that's very cool. Well,
profiles
online
should come soon.
And we should turn over to our Profiles fan page, Profiles with Malone and Mantz, where Vugura Ramanathan had this to say about There Will Be Blood. Is what my opinion, Daniel Day-Lewis's best performance, and by God, it has so many iconic scenes, especially the milkshake scene.
Yeah.
How many times do I reuse that quote in real life? The number is so high, I'm embarrassed to say. The film also had a fantastic score and the performances from Dylan Frazier, as well as Paul Dano as the Sunday Twins. Every twist and turn was exciting, and Daniel Day-Lewis was the literal representation of evil.
Oh, that is true. And the lovely possum on YouTube says, another fun fact, milkshake sales rose significantly after the release of the film.
Hashtag I got a craving now.
Well, Cathal Thomas Coleman says, There Will Be Blood is my favorite Paul Thomas Anderson film. Daniel Day-Lewis is phenomenal as always, and PTA brilliantly creates a realistic depiction of the American pioneer landscape. The ambition and greed of Daniel Plainview is riveting to watch. Robert Elswitz, Oscar-winning cinematography, is breathtaking as well. I think The Master is probably his most beautiful looking film, but There Will Be Blood follows closely after.
Well, the scene in There Will Be Blood when the oil rig catches on fire.
Oh, yeah.
Knocked my socks off.
Yes.
Beautiful, beautiful scene. And because of scenes like that, in only 7 films, including his latest movie, Inherent Vice, which is in theaters now, just 7 movies, so many great scenes to choose from in our right stuff.
Hard to choose.
What is your right stuff?
I'm going with one that's quite tragic, but I like the way it was put together and also what it meant for this film. It's from Boogie Nights. It's the long take with William H. Macy, when he kills his wife and then he commits suicide on New Year's Eve. So you see him enter, and it's quite intricate, the camera movement. He sees everybody. He goes to find his wife once again. She is the horrible character, but you don't see her at all. You see his reaction to her. And then he very calmly walks back to his car, grabs his gun, walks back through. You can hear the countdown to New Year's. And then it goes 3, 2, 1, bang. Boom. He kills his wife. Then he comes out very calmly and then shoots himself. And then, boom, it goes to the 80s.
It is a major transition between the good life and the consequence of the porn industry back in the late 70s and early 80s.
What's your right
My
stuff?
My right stuff, you just talked about how The Master is one of his most beautiful films, the way it's shot, and that is where my favorite scene comes from. This is my right stuff, the scene where Lancaster Dodd, played by the great Philip Seymour Hoffman.
Next door.
Yeah, there's a lot going on out there. Is there are profilers out there.
Come
they
on.
Want in. They want in on
no,
the live show.
Can't come in.
But this is the scene where Lancaster Dodd, played by Hoffman, is auditing or processing, as the film uses, Joaquin Phoenix.
And you see on Joaquin Phoenix's face.
It's just the close-ups on both of them, how it goes back and forth. The dynamic, the relationship between these two characters really fuels The Master to the point where we're going to have a lot to say about it when we get to talking about it later. But this scene itself, it's complex, and it is engrossing, and it is mesmerizing, and two excellent performances that complement each other.
Yeah, well, yeah. We will be talking more about that in a sec, but right now let's go to our last detail. And I also love watching everyone comments on YouTube, because everyone's like, hi Dan, hi Rachel, hi
hey everybody, we're bringing all the profiles together.
I love this so much. It's really fun doing this live. I think at one point we'll take calls, but we thought we'll start off with
just the live,
see if we can manage it all,
and then eventually we'll do this in front of a live audience.
Yeah,
right. Yeah,
that's what we want to do. We want to have a screening and then invite everyone to come and see it, and then do Q&A's with cast. Big plans.
Big plans
for profiles
in 2015.
Let's get back to the last detail. So did you know? I don't know if this is true, but I like the idea that this is true. Paul Thomas Anderson wrote most of Magnolia over 2 weeks while he was at William H. Macy's Vermont cabin. Mm-hmm. But he didn't go outside pretty much the whole time he was there because he saw a snake and he was scared.
Well, where were you? You beat up snakes in Australia.
Just get a shovel, mate.
Get a shovel, mate.
Crack it over the head. She'll be right.
You can handle it.
Totes.
Well, did you know that in The Master, the scene in the jail where Joaquin Phoenix breaks the toilet was totally improvised, but also the jail was a historical landmark, so he got in trouble for breaking the toilet.
That scene, it's amazing. The rage he has.
Hoffman's just standing there. Like,
yeah, so
cool as a cucumber, totally, right?
I love that. Okay, well, did you know that There Will Be Blood and the Coen brothers' No Country for Old Men were shooting right near each other at the same time?
Oh.
And apparently these two sets didn't always work well together, because at one point, Paul Thomas Anderson was testing a big pyrotechnic effect on There Will Be Blood, and it caused such a smoke cloud that No Country for Old Men had to halt filming for a whole day.
Now, why you think maybe these movies were released around the same time in 2007?
Yeah,
a lot of people get them confused.
Yeah, I did for a while there too.
Why? They're not the same movie.
No Country. I get confused with the titles. But now I've got it. Now we got it down. Both really good movies.
Did you know that in Magnolia?
Yeah.
The reporter who interviews Tom Cruise, who winds up, breaking him.
Yes.
The reporter who interviews Tom Cruise, the TV show that she works for, is called Profiles.
I know.
What?
I couldn't believe that you texted me that as soon as you saw
Magnolia.
I'm sitting
watching it
again
on the plane, and I have Wi-Fi on the plane, and I'm watching Magnolia on the plane. She goes, you get the guy, his bodyguard says, oh, this is such and such. She's from Profiles. And I went, what? I rewound it three times, and I'm like, oh my God, Alicia.
And then I rewatched it. I was like, that is true. It's a sign.
It's a sign.
It is
Profiles
a sign.
In 2015, ladies and gentlemen.
And the Red Bull has kicked in.
Yes, it has.
Isla Myers says, the interview scene with Tom Cruise in Magnolia always blows me away. I'm quietly judging you. Well, we will be talking more about Magnolia in a second. Right now, fast five, number four.
If you already know the answers to your questions, then why ask? Pig.
Ooh.
I had to blank out that But I just love how he bursts the master.
Well, because he does not like to be challenged. He does not handle grace under pressure. The master, okay, this movie came out September 14th, 2012, and it was nominated for 3 Academy Awards, all of them acting categories. Well-deserved Best Actor for Joaquin Phoenix, Supporting Actor Philip Seymour Hoffman, and Supporting Actress for Amy Adams. The movie cost $32 million to make, mm-hmm. and worldwide, it made 28. So it was a bomb.
Why do you think that is? It was too challenging for people to watch?
Yes, because I remember when I first saw the film at the Toronto Film Festival, I was not ready. I was not prepared for the challenge of that film, the pacing of the movie. It's an unnerving film. It's a disquieting one. It's an uncomfortable movie.
It's very uncomfortable.
However, now that once I realized what to expect with that film...
You went back in.
I went back in, and I was able to embrace all of those things. Mm-hmm. And I realized with just my second viewing that The Master is a masterpiece. Mm-hmm. And watching it for the third time, I have to say that this revisionist order that we put these movies in, that The Master is my personal favorite Paul Thomas Anderson movie.
Wow.
It is also, between There Will Be Blood and The Master, the two movies that got the most response when we asked people to weigh in on their favorite film. On our Facebook page.
Interesting. Well, I saw The Master 3 times in the cinema. The 70mm. It looked so beautiful. The first time, I agree, I saw it and I was like, I don't know if I like it. Second time, I really enjoyed it. Third time, such a treat. At the New Beverly Cinema here, it wasn't in 70mm, it was in 35. They had a marathon of all 6 at the time of Paul Thomas Anderson's movies. And I went by myself. No one would come with me, and I watched hours of Paul Thomas Anderson, one after the other after the other. It was the best day ever.
Movie geek.
It was so good. Yeah,
film
hashtag
geek for
movie
life.
Geek. Well, The Master is very intelligent, very considered film about not being able to run away from your past, obviously about psychological effects of being in a cult and the kind of people that fall into that category.
Yep.
It was very controversial here in Hollywood, wasn't it? Because it seems to be about Scientology.
Okay, let's talk about that. It was very controversial because it was so overt with its comparisons to Scientology. The cause equals Scientology. Processing equals auditing. Lancaster Dodd equals L. Ron Hubbard. Now, let's just backtrack a second here. Paul Thomas Anderson made Magnolia with Tom Cruise, who, of course, is a Scientologist.
Yeah.
So he screened The Master for Cruise, and this is all speculation just based on reports that were written. Nothing has ever been confirmed on what I'm about to say, but Cruise was obviously not happy with what he saw. They had a bit of a falling out. Apparently, it's been resolved. No one knows how well it was resolved, but obviously that was a major big deal for Tom Cruise to see a movie after he worked with this guy.
Yeah.
But this is an amazing film.
Faith.
It's about faith. It's about being accepted more than anything. Mm. And I feel like it's a movie about a relationship between a man who has no answers and a man who thinks he has the answers, but is really just making it up as he goes along.
It's really interesting to look at these two characters and you think that they are complete opposites. Or are they? Or do they get special things from each other? Is one saving the other? Or is one being saved by the idea of saving him? Fascinating. It's almost a love story between these two characters.
It is a love story. And that brings up the question, who is the master?
Oh, well, I would say Lancaster Dodd, but I have a feeling you've got another theory.
Well, my theory, listen, no theory is wrong.
No, I like your theories.
And that's what's great about interpretation.
I like thinking about things in a different way.
But you see the movie and you think, okay, the master is Philip Seymour Hoffman, Lancaster Dodd. But upon further reflection on the film, especially after screening number 3, I feel like the master is Freddie Quell. I feel like it's Joaquin Phoenix.
Mm.
Because by the end of the movie, even though Dodd has become very successful, he's sitting in a very, very big room. He's done very, very well for himself with the cause. But when he lets Freddie go and sings that song to him.
Oh, Slow Boat to China.
Slow Boat to China.
Amazing song.
And when he lets Freddie go, I feel like he's more envious of Freddie's position.
Because he's free.
He's free to live his life on his own reckless, meandering terms.
Mm.
And he just goes back off. He couldn't hold the job. And he found acceptance for a little while.
Poor lost soul, Freddie.
Poor lost soul, exactly. It sort of ends the movie on a haunting note.
And I love the way that Joaquin Phoenix embodies the character with his hunchback.
And the way he talked out of the side of his mouth.
Side of his mouth. Oh, he is so good. Cian McNerney on YouTube says, I love being reminded of these movies that I should watch again, but they're not on European Netflix and I cry a little.
But they are on Amazon and they are on iTunes.
So hopefully you can get them in Europe. I had fun rewatching everything on Amazon
yeah.
through my little Kindle. And that is not a plug because I paid for that.
So did I on iTunes. So
the lovely possum says Darth Harloff is the master. Matthew Crowe says Amy Adams is the master.
Ooh.
And Tyler Myers says, I find the master underrated, though out of all his PTA films, it's my least favorite of his. Still like it, though. And Dan Doherty says Scott Mantz is the actual master. And
way to go, Dan.
Agree.
Way to go. Give it up right here.
Well,
high five.
Okay,
one of many we got.
One.
Soft high five.
Okay. Well, from our Facebook page, Nicholas Lemos says, The Master is without a doubt one of the most underrated films of the 2010s and perhaps of all time. The film is an in-depth look into human nature and the battle between what society expects of you versus the animalistic side of man. Freddie Quill represents everything Lancaster wants to be. He mm-hmm. wants to be free
yep.
and drift among the world doing what he wants. However, the movement of the cause is growing faster than he could possibly have imagined, adding to the pressure of his own life. Whereas Freddie Quill wants what Lancaster has, control over his own life mm-hmm. and to be loved by others.
Yep.
However, his experience in the war has damaged him so severely he is unable to do so. Both Joaquin and Philip Seymour Hoffman gave the best performances of their career in a film that is truly
a masterpiece. Well, Mark Tordai, who is a devoted profiler, we love very, very much. Mark is the man. Mark had a very, very profound comment that he put on our Facebook page.
Yeah.
Profiles with Malone and Mantz. Head over there and give it a like. Mark Tordai says, I took a great interest in The Master because I used to be a member of the group the film is based on.
Wow.
And didn't want it to be riddled with cliches.
What an interesting perspective.
Very interesting perspective. After seeing The Master for the first time, I thought it was very accurate and gives PTA a lot of credit for this well-researched film. Joaquin Phoenix gives the performance of his career as Freddie Quell, a lost soul who finds purpose under Lancaster Dodd, played brilliantly by the late, great Philip Seymour Hoffman. The toughest scene for me will always be when Lancaster sings the lullaby to Freddie near the end of the film.
Yeah.
I've realized in that moment that both Freddie and Lancaster needed each other. They were both lost souls. While far from perfect, The Master helped me to make sense of my past, and it's something I show my friends and family when they ask questions, right? And to me, there is no other film that tells the truth about charismatic groups in such a brutally honest and realistic way. Thank you, Mark.
That's an amazing comment.
Amazing
I
comment.
I love that.
That goes into our comment hall of fame.
And I love watching all the comments on YouTube while we do this live the first time. There's a lot of talk about your sweater. A lot of people saying that you win. Marcus Townsend says, Scott wins the ugly Christmas sweater with that baby poop green sweater. Aww,
wait, hang on.
Come on.
Alicia Malone got this sweater for me.
Yeah, it was
so
a present.
So she gets all the credit. I love this sweater.
It was a present.
This is the best sweater.
I found this in London, Merry Christmas, you filthy animal. And I was like, you have to have one too.
Well, I love that your red sweater matches your lipstick, matches your hair, Red Fury, matches the microphone.
That's
you got
right.
the red thing going and it looks great on you.
I try.
Way to go.
I try. Okay, now we're up to our quiz show where you get to test me on my knowledge and I get to test you on your knowledge.
Hit me up.
Okay. This is a pretty easy one.
Okay.
In Punch Drunk Love, which type of food did Barry discover is best for travel points? A, pudding. B, soup. C, frozen dinner.
I'm going to say pudding.
Yay!
Because I love pudding! We love pudding! My question for you, Alicia, is from The Master, because we just were talking about it. What was the name of the yacht? What was the name of Lancaster Dodd's yacht that Freddie Quill stumbled upon?
Yeah.
Was it A, the Alicia?
Yeah.
Was it B, the Athena?
Yeah.
Or was it C, the Allegra?
The Athena?
Correct!
Yay!
We both got him! Hooray! Way to go. We deserve to get those right for our last profiles of 2014.
I know. And maybe if we start doing this live show on the reg,
yes,
on the regular, we could ask our trivia questions to people watching and see who can come up with the
great
answer.
Great idea. A lot of big changes for profiles.
Next year. Okay, now we get to fast five number three. Cheers.
Shame on you! Shame on you! Shame on both of you!
Ooh.
Wow, Magnolia.
Julie Moore, Magnolia.
I chose that bit because I love her in this role. She's great in everything.
She's great in everything, and she better win the Oscar this year for Still Alice. Oh, but yeah. I digress. Movie was released on December 19th, 1999, and nominated for 3 Academy Awards. Best Original Song for Amy Mann, Save Me. Best Original Screenplay, PTA, of course. And Supporting Actor, Tom Cruise.
Yeah.
This is Paul Thomas Anderson's Shortcuts. This Altman. Is his Robert Altman movie. And this nailed Altman's style and structure down so well that when Robert Altman was working on his final film, 2006, as A Prairie Home Companion, mm-hmm. he was not well. So PTA was sort of his understudy, shadowing him during the making of The Prairie Home Companion.
Wow.
So God forbid if he had died, if Altman had died, PTA would have been able to pick it up and finish the movie.
That's amazing.
Amazing.
And you definitely see that in this movie in terms of all the different characters. Rewatching this again for the millionth time, I am so floored by what an achievement it is that you're able to balance all these characters, and they all have an arc, they all have a journey, they all intersect in a way that makes sense. It's not
Absolutely.
Just all thrown in together, and they all have the same journey at the same time. Again, it's kind of that rise for redemption, or they start off on top and then they fall and then everything changes with the frogs.
Okay, this is it is a sprawling epic film, runs 3 hours and 8 minutes long.
Doesn't feel like it.
It doesn't.
It has so much energy, and to me it feels like a classical music piece. So it just feels like it builds. The camera's moving, the score's going, the tracking shots. It's amazing.
It's an amazing film, and this is a movie that for everyone, it is all about forgiveness, redemption, and letting go.
Sins of the father.
And did you know that the number that for Tom Cruise's
seduce and destroy.
TJ 1-877-TAME-HER. Back in 1999 and 2000, when the movie was playing in theaters, if you called that number, you actually heard the infomercial.
Oh, really?
Isn't that
like
crazy?
When Philip Seymour Hoffman's on hold.
That's
and
what
keeps
he heard.
Hearing it?
That's what you would hear. Yes, they actually
played
it.
That character is brilliant because
it really is.
Feel like it has a lot to say about those types of guys and the way it changes when he's sitting there silent and quietly judging her. I think that's. And then he comes back out.
And he comes back out. He's totally distracted.
Yeah.
Shaken up. And that's great. He goes, looking, you're yellow. I mean, you're white. And he flips the table.
God,
he's like, yeah, he's clearly.
Shaken.
I love seeing
and
Tom Cruise sleep
him.
Out.
Yeah.
And a woman took him down. Way to go. Way to go. From Profiles.
from Profiles
took him down.
Well, apparently Paul Thomas Anderson said he wanted to make something small and intimate, but then Magnolia just kept growing and blossoming. So it's definitely not a small, intimate movie, but an incredibly structured one.
And a movie that has a lot of symbolism. Listen, watching that scene with the frogs, I got the chills. Because watching everybody's reaction, like they couldn't believe what was happening. When you look at Philip Seymour Hoffman, who was so sweet in this movie, his character was such a sweet person. He's looking out like totally in shock, and Melinda Dillon in the car, and John C. Reilly in the car is like, you know, skidding out of control. Just watching their reactions to it, and first of all, the raining of the frogs comes from the Bible, Exodus 8:2, and the numbers 8 and 2. Play very prominently throughout the film. Like when you're watching the graphics and it says humidity 82%.
Yeah, wow.
But the question, Alicia, is what do you think the symbolism of that scene means?
Well, profilers, if you're watching on YouTube right now, comment what you think the symbolism of the frogs in Magnolia means, and I'll read out some in a second. For me, I mean, it just feels like it has religious overtones, and it feels like after that, that's when everything changes.
Everything changes. I feel like that was I'm not religious at all, but the symbolism of that scene is that it is a wake up call from God to these troubled lost souls that everything is going to be okay. And just the way that the song Save Me is used to play out the film, if really, you know, here's a movie that for the last 3 hours you're watching these people in the midst of these personal crisis, and for the film to end on such a positive, hopeful note is a testament to what Paul Thomas Anderson was trying to do with this movie.
Yeah, it's a hard feat to pull off, especially with the stuff at the start about coincidences. And then I love that shot, but it did happen.
But it did happen.
The painting.
Yep, the frogs are raining and it zooms in. And Stanley, the kid who played Stanley, who was terrific, goes,
he was so good.
But it did happen.
But it did happen.
Yeah.
I'm not a toy. I love that. Lots of people were saying that they should. The love song writer says we should turn the high fives into a drinking game. That would be dangerous because you would be really drunk at the end. Lovely Possum says that it can't wait to see what people think about that scene. Matthew Crowe says, Paul Thomas Anderson quote, I remember reading somewhere, if I had the money, it would have been raining cats and dogs.
Interesting.
And it was. And that's rare for LA for it to ever rain like that.
Well, Brian Lomax on our Facebook page says this about Magnolia, one of my all-time favorite movies. It is such an assault on the senses that every time I watch it, I'm feeling left battered and bruised. But in the same stroke, it leaves me feeling hopeful for the future of mankind. As we leave the film on Officer Jim Curring, played by John C. Reilly. Mm-hmm. He's the heart of this movie, by the way.
He is.
He's so good. His voiceover and that priceless glint in the eyes of Claudia that tells us everything's going to be all right. A masterpiece in every respect, from the intricate screenplay, Anderson's frenetic camera work, flawless performances from one of the best ensemble casts ever, and a fantastic soundtrack by Amy Mann to boot. What's not to love?
Blaine Granado says that scene is a really cool way to get all the characters to their catharsis. And Danny B. Review says, when the frog scene happened, my first reaction was, well, you're just doing whatever you want now, aren't you, movie?
Yeah.
And Mark Tordai is in the chat room. He says he just got his chat working and people saying congratulations on his amazing comment that he left.
Rebel
Another
Tory.
Great comment from Sandy Wilbur. Magnolia is one of my favorite films of his because it really subverts all your expectations. It's a film over 3 hours. It never gets boring. It's always moving. All the characters feel necessary. PTA puts so much humanity into each and every one of them. It's unexpectedly funny, unpretentious, and often heartfelt. And the whole resolution to this thing is just so out of control. Man, I loved it.
We loved it too.
Yes.
And we know that you have a lot to say about Paul Thomas Anderson's movies, mm-hmm. which brings us to our brackets.
Our brackets that we run on our Facebook page. It was between favorite characters in PTA movies. So it was Daniel Plainview versus Dirk Diggler, then Freddie Quill versus TJ Mackey, and then the winner of all of them, who you guess out of those four?
Frank T.J. Mackey.
No. It is Daniel Plainview.
From
There Will Be Blood.
From There Will Be Blood.
Is our profiler's favorite character from Paul Thomas Anderson movie. And once again, thanks to Steve Zissou and all the profilers who run these brackets on our site. You should go and give our Facebook a like, and you should also subscribe to us on YouTube and iTunes.
While you're doing that, yes, please go to our Facebook page right now. We'll wait while you go to our Facebook page. Open up another window on your computer while you're watching Profiles Live. Go to Facebook. Go to our Facebook page, Profiles with Malone and Mantz. Give us a like, join in on the fun, be part of the conversation, because Profiles is all about our love for film, and that includes our profiler friends from around the world. Check us out on iTunes, and this is actually really, really important. Please subscribe to our podcast on iTunes. Even if you think you're already a subscriber, please go back and subscribe again, or even if you are a subscriber, please rate and review us. Cannot stress to you how important it is. Those ratings and reviews are to us. Go to iTunes, rate and review us on iTunes. We need them.
Yeah, we need them, and we're trying to keep pushing the show out to as many people as we can, so we love when you guys share it with everyone, and we love reading all your comments and having I feel like you're all here with me in the room here with us, and we can actually talk to each other. This is quite nice. But let's keep things going with our Fast Five number two.
I have a love in my life. It makes me stronger than anything you can imagine. I would say that's that mattress man.
Punch truck love.
That's that mattress man.
That's that mattress man.
This is my personal favorite out of all of Paul Thomas Anderson's movies, I think, because it is sweet.
It's a
sweet love story.
It's his only love story. It has the biggest heart of any of the movies he ever made. And it is also his shortest movie, coming in at a whopping 95 minutes,
released on
November 1st, 2002. And this movie won Paul Thomas Anderson Best Director at that year's Cannes Film Festival. Festival, and Adam Sandler was nominated for Golden Globe Best Actor in a Comedy, this was a major departure for both filmmaker and actor.
Yeah, well, apparently Paul Thomas Anderson said he wanted to make an Adam Sandler comedy because he loves Adam Sandler. So he would always love turning on an Adam Sandler movie when he was feeling down. That was what he wanted to make. He ended up making something, of course, very considered, very intelligent, something very different for Adam Sandler. But I think he used all of Adam Sandler's trademarks in the best way. So he's got the rage that he explodes out. He's got the humor. It is very darkly funny. I think he was perfectly cast. And to me, it felt like Robert De Niro in I got right down. Camp Comedy.
Oh, okay.
How could I forget Scorsese movie?
Come you got to check this out, okay? I went back and I realized I actually did review this movie when it came out in 2002.
Yeah.
And in my original review, which was posted on October 11th, 2002, I said, as strange as it may seem, the real revelation here is none other than Adam Sandler, who does away with the goofball image in favor of a surprisingly heartfelt and ultimately sad performance that in some ways, are you ready for this, Leash? Some ways recalls Robert De Niro's Travis Bickle.
Oh, really?
From Taxi Driver. But hey, right? De Niro.
On the same page
as always. Another high five for that one. Sandler's tender, introverted desperation has him crying out for help to anyone who will listen, which no one does, before flying into a rage that is out of control and sheer frustration.
I love the scene with his sisters. How annoying are those sisters?
Seven of them.
And I mean, I don't know if the sisters were really like that in reality or if that is his perception of how they are, but so annoying. You understand why he suddenly explodes and then kicks the doors down.
The windows,
down.
And he freaks out in the bathroom.
Oh, yeah, I love that. My sister's a liar. I have to go to the bathroom.
Well, this is a film that is, it's quirky, it's offbeat, it's charming, it is very bizarre and very surreal, which is why in talking about PTA's movies, we talked about Scorsese, mm-hmm. we talked about Altman, mm-hmm. we talked about Kubrick. I think I might be in the minority on that one, but that's
okay. No, I see your point, so I agree.
Okay, but this movie, okay, Punch Drunk Love, I felt like this was PTA channeling. Are you ready for this?
Yeah.
PTA channeling David Lynch.
Oh, because it gets quite surreal?
It starts off with a moment that... With a bang that... People really don't understand what the significance is. Like when Kyle MacLachlan found the ear in the beginning of Blue Velvet.
True, which
it
is one of my
favorites. It sets things off, which is one of your favorites because you have a t-shirt to match
yeah,
it.
Yeah, and Paul Thomas Anderson says about that car crash that he wanted to start with a big bang because it was like in a concert when a band starts with their biggest hit so that you'll listen to all the rest of the songs.
What do you think the significance...
It makes me jump every time.
It does. Even though you're expecting it. It starts off the movie.
Yeah.
But what do you think the significance is of that crash? What does it mean?
Is it like his life is coming to a head? It's everything's about to crash?
Exactly. Everything is about to change.
Everything's about to change.
And it does.
It does.
And another moment, Lena, so sweet. I mean, Emily Watson is so delightful and charming.
Mm-hmm.
And I was reading on, I think it was either Facebook or Twitter, that one of our profilers said that the lovely Lena reminded him of the lovely Alicia Malone.
Oh, yeah, I saw that. I was like, I'll take that.
She's so compliment.
Sweet. Another scene I love is the payphone in Hawaii. When he finally gets to talk to her, how the light comes on. And that to me is like the light, she saves him and the love saves him and he finally changes. And I think I relate to him not in the rage part, but definitely in the way that he's timid and then he learns to stand up for himself.
Well, what do you think the harmonium means to this film? Because the score composed by John Bryan. Now, usually a filmmaker will have a rough cut and the composer will go off and compose the music mm-hmm. for it. But John Bryan actually brought a harmonium to the set, composed part of the score while the film was rolling.
That's amazing.
While they were doing principal photography.
Wow.
And he would use the harmonium, which would actually fuel PTA's direction and, of course, fuel Adam Sandler's remarkable performance.
Yeah, because at times there is so much going on with, I remember the scene when he's on the phone to the mattress man and shut up.
There's
a forklift going and then there's the music and there's just so much happening. It feels stressful to watch it. And then when Lena comes in, it calms down. But I think the harmonium maybe is harmony.
Well, it's harmony because, and I was going to ask you, what do you think the symbolism is with the harmonium? Because it keeps popping up. Well,
what do you think, profilers?
What do you think, profilers? Let us know mm-hmm. on our live feed right now. I think the harmonium represents, he's learning how to play it throughout the course of the film while he's learning how to love.
Aww.
I don't know, it might be a stretch.
No, I like that.
Yeah, I'm a bit of a sap.
I like that. And Paul Thomas Anderson definitely considers everything in his film. So
yes, he does.
I think nothing is there just for the hell of it. Well, Mark Tordai.
Again. We love Mark Tordai.
He made two comments today. Says, I was a big fan of Adam Sandler growing up, especially after seeing Billy Madison and Happy Gilmore. However, at the beginning of the new millennium, Adam's comedies got very repetitive. In a unique career choice, Adam starred in Punch Drunk Love and showed audiences he could do drama as well as he could do comedy. Punch Drunk is a dark film and one with yet another great Philip Seymour Hoffman performance. Yeah,
Philip Seymour Hoffman.
In a PTA-directed movie. While I certainly love Adam Sandler's early comedies, Punch Drunk Love is also on my list of my favorite Adam Sandler films. This one is often overlooked, but is certainly one of PTA's best.
And Brian Williams, who took a break from hosting NBC Nightly News. Way to go, Brian! Well, he says, my pick for my favorite PTA film is Punch Drunk Love. While not a Sandler fan in the traditional sense, I was completely won over by his Barry Egan. In my opinion, it's one of the great performances of the last decade. Wow. The chemistry of the two leads is off the charts, with the luminous Emily Watson doing a lot of the heavy lifting here. Yeah. We have to buy her falling in love with Barry.
It's true.
And it's true. Yeah, totally. And for me, there was never a doubt. Lastly, it comes down to PTA, who has thrown a lot of things at the audience. Pudding, phone sex, mattress men, a harmonium, seven sisters, four Mormons, Louis Guzman, a trip to Hawaii.
Oh, yeah.
Wow, he's a fan. And it never feels bogged down. That's true. It doesn't.
Yeah.
It doesn't feel contrived. Everything feels out of everything feels of a piece. This is helped brought to life with the help of John Bryant's awesome score, the always reliable DP Robert Elswit, and Jeremy Blake's wonderful artwork that is used like chapter breaks. It all works so brilliantly, so true.
It really does. Now over on YouTube, Matthew Crow says, Punch Drunk has the best use of a lens flare. When Emily Watson and Adam Sandler meet for the first time, a flare forms a rainbow. I don't know whether it was intentional, but it's very fitting for them.
Aww.
I love that. And also, just a quick one before we move on from Punch Drunk Love. Did you know that it's partly based on a true story of the Pudding Man?
No.
A guy in California who actually outsmarted Healthy Choice. He bought $3,140 worth of pudding, and he received 1,253,000 points, which means unlimited flights forever.
That is what you get for having a loophole in the fine print.
Love that.
Love it.
Well,
sticking it to the man.
Sticking it to man. Well, as we mentioned, Paul Thomas Anderson has seven movies that he's made. We've chosen our favorite five, but we want to give a shout out, a tip of the pretend hat to the other two that we haven't talked about yet. So in The Others, we're going to speak about, firstly, Hard Eight,
an criminally underseen movie, but first played at the Sundance Film Festival in 1996, though it wasn't released in theaters until February 28th, 1996.
No one saw it.
I mean, it didn't even make $1 million at the box office, but it did win PTA Best New Filmmaker by the Boston Society of Film Critics, and it was nominated for 5 Independent Spirit Awards.
Oh, wow. Well, yeah. I only saw this for the first time when I watched the marathon of movies, and it's very much an understated film, very much about these three lonely characters and a mentor relationship that forms, but it's a film noir as well. It does have definite style of PTA with the tracking shot through the casino.
It's a low-key movie,
not as flashy as Paul Thomas Anderson's latest film,
Inherent Vice.
What do we say about Inherent Vice? See it multiple times.
See it a lot of times. And we've been talking about throughout the course of the show how you have to see his movies more than once. Mm-hmm. And Inherent Vice is one of those movies. There's a whole lot of movie there, and there's a whole lot to like the first time you see it. But the story and the characters, it does get a little confusing at times.
Very confusing.
But when you watch a film that you don't like and you just go, oh, whatever, and then you watch a movie like Inherent Vice and you're like, I gotta see that again. I wanna see that again.
Yeah.
And that's crucial. That's what makes Inherent Vice special, because ultimately this is a film that is a cross between Chinatown and The Big Lebowski.
Yeah, it's like a stoner comedy meets a film noir detective movie. It's bizarre. I saw it twice on the same day
day.
My head around it. But one of the best parts about Inherent Vice for me are the scenes between Joaquin Phoenix and Josh Brolin.
Oh, he steals the movie.
And Josh Brolin, one of our favorite people to talk to, because he is, and he admits this, he's a film geek.
And we got the chance to talk with him on our show.
Just for us.
Just for us. Just for Profiles. Thanks, Warner Brothers, for reaching out and making that happen and supporting Profiles, a show by film lovers for film lovers. So let's roll our interview with Inherent Vice star Josh Brolin right now.
We're ready. This is special. This is your show.
This is our show.
This is your 16th week into your show.
Yes.
About, and this week is about, sorry, next week is about,
Paul
right now
Thomas
is about.
Anderson.
Right.
Our show is Profiles. Our next spotlight is on Paul Thomas Anderson, and you just made Inherent Vice.
With?
Paul Thomas Anderson.
Amazing.
You see the connection?
So
see
let's
the connection?
Start off
this
with
is amazing.
This is amazing.
Let's start off with something simple. You play Detective Bigfoot, kind of a jerk.
Mm-hmm.
A little bit. How would you describe him?
Well, you just described him. Kind of a jerk. I think he's pathetic. He's more pathetic than he is a jerk so much. You know, I mean, his relationship with Doc is almost a marriage, I think. A very dysfunctional one at that. But I think, you know, I mean, he's a multifaceted guy on the lower end of the, you know, human spectrum. So you see him with his wife, he's getting yelled at. You see him with his kids are pouring him a drink. You see him with Doc, and he's having this conversation where he's totally manipulating him. And then you see him at the end, and he's the guy that loses it completely because he has the least amount of strength. So I think he is multifaceted, but down here, down here.
Well, this is Paul Thomas Anderson's seventh movie as a director.
Right.
What is it about his films, especially in this one, that makes him different from other filmmakers you've worked with, and you've worked with the greats?
I mean, he's just one, he is one of the greats. And what constitutes one of the greats is somebody who can create an ambiance that is electrical for actors, but then also has some kind of, you know, structural discipline. And he has amazing, I mean, he does, you'd never know it when you talk to him, that he has, obviously very intelligent, but he's done an enormous amount of like prep and all that kind of stuff. And then when you get to the set, he's more like, you know, I don't know, what do you want to do? What do you want to do? So he's willing to be instinctual, but he's also very prepared at the same time. So I don't know, you see his movies, you look at, you know, Sydney, which was what, Hard Eight. You look at Boogie Nights, you look at, you know, There Will Be Blood, you look at Magnolia, you look at all these films, and you realize that this guy can go in any direction. He's just really good at telling a story.
Very much so.
Is it hard to define a Paul Thomas Anderson film? Because it seems like they're all so different from each other. This one is different again.
No, it's completely different. And no, not there's no through line to all the films, I don't think. But every film is very definably him. You know what I mean? If you get to know him at all, you realize, oh yeah, that's There Will Be Blood. That's and that's that film, and that's that film. But he's so, I think his interest is like, he has so many hands and so many jars just via his personality that you understand how somebody like that can do that. You see some filmmakers that will make the same film over and over and they love a genre that they do. He's, you know, he's much more scattered than that.
But how is he working with actors? I mean, some directors are very hands-on, give a lot of direction, as they should because they are the director, and others are more concerned with just the look and really just trust the actors to do their thing because, I mean, that's their
I
job.
Think he's both. I think you don't, you know, I think like the Coen brothers are very, you know, they're hands-on, but they're not so much. They're not very, you know, Paul will get in there and he'll start, I mean, he wants everybody to completely open up and feel that kind of familial buzz that you get in a creative environment. And you know, all that sounds so pretentious, but it's that's what he creates, and he can't help but create it because he is that. He was like born that. I could see him as a child putting blocks together, but then they start going that way and that way and that way, you know. And he creates a situation on the set that I think is so creatively alive that you get addicted to it, you know. And then you have to actually go through something when the film's over. You're like, oh man, I gotta go home, and go to sleep, and watch TV. That's no fun.
And this one, your scenes with Joaquin Phoenix were my favorite.
Oh, good.
So good, the back and forth between you. Joaquin's worked with Paul Thomas Anderson before.
Yeah, great.
Did you
movie.
Notice they had a little shortcut or something?
Total shortcut. No. It's not very verbal. I did not, you know, they could look at each other and they could just go, what do you, you know, and then you just get a nod of the head or whatever, and then he'd do something completely different. But that's what you get. I have that working with the Coens for three times now, and you have a thing. But I had it with him too, but in a very different way. Both enjoy gabbing, you know, talking, and we were able to go into the book and talk about different facets of the book and all that. But then when you show up on set and end up doing a scene, it's very, you know, there's something like it's like an infancy. You know, you think you can know everything, and then not until you show up and do it. And he likes that. He likes that kind of uncertainty, you know? And you feel that watching the film. There's this kind of like on edge thing always, especially with Bigfoot and Doc. Yeah. I think.
That's true. Yeah.
Well, last question. Other than Inherent Vice, mm-hmm. what are your favorite Paul Thomas Anderson movies and why?
Wow, man, they're all great. And I don't say that because it's a publicity thing. I say that because I love his films. You know, I mean, There Will Be Blood to me was an unbelievable film, but I didn't love it when I first saw it. And then my third time that I saw it, it turned out to be one of my favorite films. So Boogie Nights, I think, was amazing. Heart 8 was incredible for a first film. I can't believe that was his first film.
Yeah. And he was young.
And he was really young. And you see, if you ever watch the extras or whatever behind this, I mean, it's fun to watch him because he's so impassioned. He's so into it. So, you know, it's fun working with somebody like that. He's a little kid with some maturity in there somewhere.
Thank you so much. We love that you're a film geek just like us.
Yeah. Just like us. Thanks for joining us on Profile Stuff.
Thanks, man.
Yes! All right! One more time! Okay. Yes!
All right.
Wasn't that a awesome interview? He was so great. He loved it. He really talked to us about it. So what is Profiles? Oh, I really like this. Hang on, so do you do actors? I get it. And he just really enjoyed speaking to us about this.
Remember he said, what happens when you run out of people? Like, I said, we will never run out of people.
Yeah, we've got cinematographers, we've got composers. And he was like, good answer.
We will good go answer. On forever as long as you support us. So please keep doing that.
Everyone in the chat seemed to enjoy that interview. Maggie Ozen says, so far this is my favorite Profiles interview next to the Francis Ford Coppola one.
Yes.
And Jeff 94 says, Marvel Movie News must be a bit jealous. Yes, we got Thanos, and sorry, Marvel Movie News, we didn't ask any questions about that.
No superhero movies. We kept it. We stayed on top of it, PTA.
Now, before we move on to our number one, which I think you can guess what that
pretty
is,
obvious.
Just wanted to read out this comment from George McCann about Inherent Vice. My favorite PTA film is actually Inherent Vice. I don't want to say why, because many people haven't seen the film just yet, so I'll say why I love PTA as a filmmaker. All his films tell a different story with the same style. He utilizes simple filmmaking tools like a character walking into frame and make it look special. Two scenes later, he will have a sweeping tracking shot. PTA knows when to go simple and when to go big. He is an artist, pure and simple. None of his films cater to the Hollywood norms, and he's not really looking to please anyone. PTA loves movies, and he loves making movies. He is a true artist and a real fan of cinema, so he must be a film geek.
And that brings us to the moment of truth. Our number one PTA movie for Profiles is...
Are you going to take your skates off?
I don't take my skates off.
Boogie Nights.
Boogie Nights, Roller Girl, and Dirk Diggler. Boogie Nights came out October 10th, 1997. Nominated for 3 Academy Awards, original screenplay for PTA. Supporting actress, Julia Moore. She better win this year for Still Alice. And supporting actor for Burt Reynolds.
Yeah, who fired his agent after seeing the film because he didn't like it, even though he got nominated for an Oscar. Poor JTE.
And
he's dealing with technical problems, but he's running around flailing his arms.
Way to go, JTE, the unsung hero.
Oh yeah,
we love JTE. Couldn't do any of this without you. You are one of us, my friend, the man. Again, we talked about how this is PTA channeling Martin Scorsese. It's his Goodfellas. We talked a lot about this film already. Cost $15 million to make. Made $43 million worldwide. This is an exhilarating movie about pleasure and excess and the consequences of both.
Yeah, the first half is so much fun to watch as Dirk Diggler experiences all the highs of working in an industry that I'm sure many guys would be like, that seems like a good job, especially when you have people like Roller Girl. This is the film that really put PTA on the map. I mentioned the soundtrack. I love it. It's got so much energy as well with the tracking shots and the camera movements and all the characters. The opening shot, which we mentioned, one thing I love about that tracking shot is you get to meet the 12 different characters that you get to know later on.
Absolutely.
But the last half is quite sad.
Oh,
really,
it's depressing.
Tragic. Yeah. I mean, the moment with Roller Girl in the car, that's heartbreaking.
It is heartbreaking. A lot of heartbreaking scenes in the last part of that movie. And very, very intense. The scene with Thomas Jane and Mark Wahlberg at Alfred Molina's place.
Everything
the guy throwing
crazy.
The firecracker. I mean, that
you're on the edge.
Oh, so on the edge. One of the most intense single scenes. That almost was my right stuff.
Mm.
Just because it's just so, so intense. This is, obviously, we just said, it was Paul Thomas Anderson's breakthrough movie.
Such such a big leap too, from Hard Eight to Boogie Nights. Huge leap.
Love that, how videotape changed the porn industry.
Yeah.
And videotape is where you saw Boogie Nights for
the first time. Yep. And the internet changed porn as well. No stories anymore. I liked the cheesy acting, but anyway, now it's just the money shot. As we mentioned, Mark Wahlberg has never been better. It's got a big heart.
It does have a big heart. And you know, just like Mark Wahlberg in this movie, Alicia Malone and Scott Mantz, we're going to be big, bright, shiny stars.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's going to be my mantra now when I feel nervous. Before, I'm a beautiful, unique snowflake, you know, from Fight Club, just twisted. And now it's just going to be, I'm a star. I'm a big, bright, shiny star. Love how that ends.
Seb Lacey says, my favorite PTA film is Boogie Nights. Such a great ensemble cast with wonderful performances from Mark Wahlberg, Julianne Moore, John C. Reilly, Burt Reynolds, and the rest of the cast. Special mention to Philip Seymour Hoffman. The film itself is so interesting. Who can forget the opening Steadicam scene, which is a great introduction to the world that we know rarely about. It is wonderful to see the time progression. It remains my favorite film about the 70s.
Ma'am S. Mac on YouTube says, Julianne Moore's character in this movie is heartbreaking.
Amber Waves.
Such a lost soul. And Rachel Cushing is killing it on the chat. She says, it shines a light on the darker side of entertainment, but treats it the same as anything else, thus showing that it always comes down to fame, greed, talent, and relationships.
And Liam Logrand, big shout out to Liam, because not only is he a great profiler, but he is my favorite Beatles fan in the world.
And he's watching right now. We're at 6:54 a.m. tomorrow.
Way to go. Let us know what those lottery numbers are, Liam. Says Boogie Nights is PTA's interpretation of the American dream through the perspective of high school dropout who believes that his passion of being a porn star is considered a job of high class. Marky Mark, yes, exactly. That's what he was up to that point. Yeah. Gives the best performance of his career as Dirk Diggler, providing humorous and dramatic acting when required. Just want to say that Mark Wahlberg's performance in The Gambler is actually the performance of his career. That movie is in theaters. Christmas, great film.
I haven't seen that yet.
Seeing his rise and downfall being taken advantage of by the porn industry is enjoyable yet depressing at the same time. His desperateness to obtain money throughout the second act of the film is shocking. PTA perfectly captures the dark side of the porn industry, showing the consequences of being associated with this business and how it can affect your personal identity in society. See this movie if you are a true hashtag film geek.
And that brings us to the end of our PTA profiles. So let's just recap our top five. I can see you're already getting emotional. Number five, There Will Be Blood.
Number four, The Master. Number three, Magnolia. Number two, Punch Drunk Love. Number one, Boogie Nights. And ladies and gentlemen, 18 episodes of profiles under our belts, and we are so grateful. And I just have to say, Alicia, doing profiles with you week after week is just such a pure and absolute joy.
Aww.
What am I going to do with myself for these next 3 weeks? Until we return, our first show for 2015 is our spotlight on the amazing, the one and only Tim Burton.
Let's hear a little bit.
Beetlejuice.
It's showtime.
So and much to talk about with that.
Should we tell them now?
Oh, yes. Let's tell them now.
And our big get is we did, in fact, sit down. Alicia Malone and Scott Mantz, we sat down to talk with the man himself, Tim Burton.
Yes.
That is going to be our first show
just
in 2015.
Profiles. And that was one of my favorite interviews I've done all year, besides Francis Ford Coppola. And Mantz, I just want to say, it's been an absolute joy to talk to you about films every single week. Your knowledge makes everything it makes everything so worthwhile, and you're so smart and intelligent, and I said many things and I'm getting my words all confused, but I love you.
But I love you too. and Merry Christmas.
Oh no, I didn't get you anything.
Merry Christmas, Alicia Malone.
Thank you. Should I open it now?
Yes, you should.
Okay, quickly.
Because
I know the next show is like, we need to get in here.
That's okay.
Oh, you got me another notebook.
Yes, I did.
Another Wonder Woman notebook. I filled mine up with profiles notes, so yay.
Thank you
so much.
Well, nothing says Wonder Woman more than Alicia Malone. I'm telling you, this is a woman. This is an extraordinary voice. voice in film. She is the best with a capital B. I feel lucky and honored and working with Alicia Malone on Profiles every week.
Thanks
is the highlight.
For joining
Thank you. Happy New Year from Profiles. Woohoo!
From producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, Christian Harloff, and the entire Popcorn Talk Network, we would like to thank you for tuning in. For questions or comments, be sure to visit popcorntalk.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of the Popcorn Talk Network.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of its owners or principals.